His reviews will get you further than the film will ever go. If you give him just a moment of your time, he'll let you know. Which movies rock, which movies stink, which movies shouldn't have been released. Say hello to Confused Matthew.
Sometimes with these requested reviews, I often try to guess the motivations behind why someone would want me to review these films. If someone wants me to review There Will Be Blood, maybe they want to hear my take on minimalism used in that film when compared to 2001. If someone wants me to review The Secret of Nim, maybe they want to hear my take on a more darker children's film when compared to the others that I've reviewed. But here, there can be no question. If someone is requesting that I review Steven Spielberg's AI, it means they hate me. Contrary to the popular opinions that grew out of my Minority Report review, I actually like Steven Spielberg and his movies for the most part, though I think that review probably shot any hope I had of getting an autograph in the foot. It's only around the time that he took up the mantle of this project that he started making dismally poor decisions with regard to the films he took on. AI is when Steven Spielberg's movies really started to suck, and he's never really made that great Steven Spielberg movie since. The Terminal was good, Catch Me If You Can was good, but neither film was truly great the way his projects used to be. This film suffers from another handicap, which is that Steven Spielberg actually wrote this movie. Spielberg doesn't usually do that. He is, or rather used to be, very good at two things: shooting a movie and picking a good screenplay to shoot. But in my view, with the exception of Close Encounters of the Third Kind, he's not a very good writer. And that's fine, because unlike others in his field, he usually sticks to what he does best: directing. Here, that is not the case, and this film exemplifies all of his weaknesses as a writer. AI, which should have been an idea movie, is nothing more than a situation movie with a few ideas slapped on here and there. A team of scientists are attempting to make the first artificial being that can feel, not think, feel. That was his first mistake, giving an artificial being one emotion and then telling them to run with it as soon as someone tells them a code locks them into one objective. That actually runs contrary to what is being said of David in this film. At the end of the film, and I know I'm jumping all around at this point, so please bear with me, David is told by his creator that he is the only artificial being that ever wanted something that they weren't told to want. But you did, friend. You did tell him what to want. It's not like he chose to love his mom. You made it so that anyone who spoke words in a certain order was going to be loved by this kid forever. Everything David does in the film is a direct result of his programming. The only thing that changes is David's way of solving those problems, but even when he tries to solve them on his own, his solutions are still a product of logically concluding the best way to achieve a goal that someone else gave him. Even if you want to argue that David's independent goal here was tracking down the blue fairy and not necessarily getting his mom to love him, this still doesn't equal an independent goal, because the blue fairy is just a means to a predetermined end. Then we have a few minor problems with the character David himself. His unique nature of independent thought seems to stem from forcing him to love. I'm not really familiar with any theory of the mind that says that love can cause the intellect, but this is another problem. It's never made clear enough exactly how David differs from the other AI in this film. They all seem perfectly capable of independent thought and problem-solving to some degree. Joe in particular makes decisions that best fit the outcome that he desires. Hell, the same could be said for the teddy bear at times. But this is the ultimate problem. No ideas are presented and then resolved here. This is nothing more than a stock journey picture, and it's not even very good at that. Two parents have a boy, who turns out to be Simba, that is sick and in kind of a stasis. So they get David to essentially stand in for him, but then Simba comes back and they abandon the boy, and the boy must find his way back. That's not an idea, it's just a situation. It would make no appreciable difference if the film had been about this. A girl's boyfriend is in some kind of medical stasis, and the girlfriend gets an artificial boyfriend, but then the real boyfriend comes back and the AI boyfriend is abandoned and must find his way back to her. See? It's the same thing. Not an idea, just a situation. This movie isn't saying anything about the bond between mother and child any more than that movie would be saying anything about the bond between boyfriend and girlfriend. When you forego all ideas and characters in your film, this is what you get. Just one situation passively playing itself out. The only discernible message that might be found in this thing is that when you make someone love you, it becomes a responsibility. But even that isn't handled very well. These parents aren't not taking responsibility for David because they're irresponsible. They abandon him because Simba set him up to do a few dangerous things. So it was actually the responsible thing to try and lose him. The characters in this film are ridiculously thin and one-dimensional. No one really has a personality above the level of the teddy bear. They're all robots. David in particular was set up terribly. His introduction scene was more like a horror movie than a chance for us to really warm up to him. Thank God for Jude Law in this movie, the only hint of a character that we ever get. Nothing really pulls us through David's experience in this film because there isn't much to care about in this movie. The only real conflicts come during the flesh fair, but then there was another problem. We got a bunch of really pissed off people who don't like technology, but while the film brushes against the subject here and there, it never has the guts to come out and say that these are religious zealots. So there's no real issue to explore here. We get a bare bones situation regarding bigotry and prejudice, but the film isn't saying anything about prejudice, they just do it and then move on. Aside from that, nothing really happens in the film. And this fact is more laughable when they finally get to David's maker and he explains that Dr. No was the only time they ever intervened. Well, intervened on what? There wasn't really any kind of a journey here. After the flesh fair, what happened? They went to go see Dr. No, then they came here. Every conflict along the way in this film is either void of meaning or more manufactured than the robot boy himself. For example, we are told in the beginning that once these new kid robots are given to a family, a series of words must be spoken which will activate their love. I can't even believe I just said that. And after this, they will love the parents forever. But here's where the manufactured retardation comes in. Once this is done, they can't make these kids unlove the parents. Ever, which means that they will have to be devoted to them forever and can never be resold. So if an adopted parent decides they don't want to keep the child, they can return it for any freaking reason, and it will have to be destroyed. They'll be bankrupt in a year! What kind of business sense does that make? Imagine if everything worked that way. We're going to make each PS3 for only one specific owner. If the owner gets tired of it or doesn't like it, bring it back to Sony for destruction. We'll just keep on making new ones for new customers. What is the point of making a mega expensive product if there is zero possibility of resale? The reason this retardation was written into the screenplay is because it gives David a stock, one-way conflict. David will be destroyed if they don't keep him. Steven, why do you have to do that? How can you not see that giving them the ability to make David unlove Monica would have created an even better and more meaningful conflict? First, David's love for Monica should never have been due to a spoken code. It should have evolved naturally. Then when they decided they can't keep him, he should have been returned to his maker and told that he will be reset, only to proclaim that he would rather die than not love Monica anymore. You had a perfectly good and meaningful conflict right there, and you squandered it just to play it safe. AI is once again lazy science fiction and lazy storytelling. It never seems to really care about itself enough to engage us in anything but a situational quest story. And let's not forget the bullshit ending. I'll sum this up for you real quick. What? 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 The only things in the film that I really liked were when the audience at the flesh fair couldn't tell the difference between David and a real boy. Boy howdy, that was almost an idea. And the character David, while not offering much in the way of character or personality, does gradually behave more and more human as the film goes on. That was well done. Other than that, the film was one big missed opportunity. Now, the only reason I'm mentioning this is because if I don't bring this up, I'll be asked why I didn't bring it up for the rest of my life. This film was originally going to be a Stanley Kubrick film, but Steven took over after the man's death. The reason I wasn't going to bring that up is because that fact is really just a trivia question at this point. Kubrick had been working on AI on and off for decades. A few writers came and went on the project, and Steven and Stanley went back and forth on which one was going to direct, but the final product Steven produced is worlds away from the movie that Kubrick would have made. This is not a Stanley Kubrick movie. His credit at the beginning is more sentimental and honorary than anything else. The only thing worse than a bad movie is a bad movie that had so much potential to be good, but fails because the writer wasn't willing to go anywhere meaningful with it. And that is exactly what AI turned out to be. About the best I can say for it is that it wasn't god-fucking-awful, but it was bad, and it didn't need to be. No real anger here, just lots and lots of shame.